In September, the Trump administration ordered federal agencies to stop offering employees certain diversity training on racial and gender biases. The executive order on combating race and sex stereotyping labels the teachings as a divisive and malign ideology. Along with government agencies, the ban also applies to its contractors and grantees. To be in compliance with the order, companies must eliminate any training that suggests implicit racial and gender biases exist. And now, private companies across the country have reportedly also felt the impact of the president's order. Glenn Harris is the publisher of Colorlines and the president of Race Forward, a nonprofit that created the Government Alliance on Race and Equity. He joins me now from Oakland, California. It's good to have you with us. You work with a network of local governments to help achieve racial equity and advance opportunities for all. How does the president's executive order impact your mission?
Thank you, Lana. It's great to be with you all. It's worth just being really clear about what the executive order is. And it is, in fact, another example of demagoguery coming from the administration rather than democracy, rather than democratic practice. At its core, it's talking about things like banning words like systemic racism, unconscious bias. And we know these are words that are common in everyday speech across the country. From our own research, we know that in the month of June alone, in the wake of the murder of George Floyd, that we saw over that the number of references to the term systemic racism in the print media in June was greater than the last 30 years combined. And it is that idea, can we have a conversation about race and equity, that is fundamentally trying to be undermined by this administration. And what we see in the jurisdictions that we work with across the country is folks rejecting that as an idea outright, that in fact, we must lean into being able to have conversations about race, gender, and equity in order to ensure that we can have a just multiracial democratic society.
Glenn, I'm wondering if you find it hypocritical that this is coming from the administration, the Trump administration, which has also complained so much about violations of their ability, their First Amendment rights, and their ability to free speech, for them to then be saying companies, contractors, government agencies can't talk at all about concepts of systemic racism and implicit biases that exist in our country.
Absolutely. First off, we can't change something we can't name. And if anything has demonstrated over the summer, it is very clearly that systemic racism, whether we're thinking about COVID-19 and its impact on the Black community, the Latinx community, the Indigenous community, or the Asian and Pacific Islander community, that systemic racism has been laid bare. We've seen it in the 25 million people who've shown up in protest about the systemic racism we see in our criminal justice system. And in this moment, when people are demanding us to have a national dialogue about how we move forward, there is no question that this is simply, again, about promoting fear, about promoting, if we're honest, hatred, as a way to avoid what we see in our work, which is that overwhelmingly people want to have this conversation. They want to have it in an open and honest way, and folks are looking for a path forward.
Glenn, what impact is the president's executive order having on colleges and universities, bastions supposedly of free speech and thought?
And I think you named it, which is how, again, I will just, you know, repeat that as we think about what it means for us to be able to make change, the very first thing is that we have to be able to have open and honest dialogue. And we see that on college campuses. We see that within museums that we work with. We see that with institutions across the board, that in the wake of the murder of George Floyd, folks are very much interested, their staff, their communities, and having a discussion about what this means for our communities, our future, and our possibilities. And so in that way, think that it's actually critical that we lean into the possibility of dialogue as a way of thinking about how we can move collectively forward.
All right, so much more to dive into here. We will stay on it. Glenn Harris, thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.